Thank you, Doctor, for the introduction, and I'm excited to share some of the results we have been seeing using the QTLseq for identifying regions linked to this trait. So we received several sources from Bolivia a couple of years ago, and we have been started working with them. So one of those sources, it was expressing this black exocarp. In Spanish, they are called vaina negra, which translates to black pods. You can see them in the slide. We have been tested these to as indicators of peanut pod maturity, although it's not as one-to-one relationship to the current methods we have looking at the mesocarp. We found that we can certainly use this trait to determine maturity in peanuts. We have also realized that it is controlled by a single gene. This was also seen by Dr. Branch in 1997, and we saw this on 2017. We are interested in other agronomic uses and in the genetics background of this trait. Here you can see a comparison of coloration with Georgia OxyG. When we plate shell extracts in petri dishes and we inoculate them with Aspergillus parasiticus, we see that the black pods reduce some of the growth of the Aspergillus parasiticus compared to other treatments like extracts from Georgia OxyG or methanol, which is what we extracted in a control, which didn't have any other extracts. We are interested on seeing more of how this is controlled, and this is why we are focusing more into the genetics part of this trait. So our hypothesis is that this trait is controlled by a single gene. Therefore, there must be only one genomic region or one annotated gene linked to this, that we can link to this trait. We believe that the QTLseq pipeline will allow us to identify the candidate SNPs linked to this, to the black pod trait. And the objective of this research was to first develop a population to conduct the QTLseq analysis and to identify one or two genomic regions as well as SNPs linked to the black pod trait. For this, we use FloRun 331 UOF variety and the black pods as parents with the bell of F2 and F3 populations. We extracted DNA and sent the samples for sequencing by Rapid Genomics in Gainesville, Florida. And after we got the results, we used the QTLseq pipeline to evaluate all the data. We also used QTLseq-R package, and that helped us in the calculation of the SNP index, delta SNP index, and the G statistics to evaluate the results we were looking at. To develop the population, we did a cross between FloRun 331 and the black pods in 2016. In 2017, we grew the F1s. And as you can see, we were mainly focusing on those plants that were expressing that black pod trait. In 2018, we planted every single seed of that F1 plants in the field, and we started seeing some segregation between the coloration of the pods. Whenever we feed that segregation to a 3-to-1 ratio, we see that it actually fits that 3-to-1 ratio, just like Dr. Branch and myself saw in all the populations. And lastly, in 2019, we harvested those plants, and then we planted them into a plant-to-plot basis in 2019 to see which one of those were segregating and which ones were not segregating. So basically what we did is we selected those plants that were not segregating for the black pods and those that were not segregating for the for Norman white pods. Those that were segregating and showed a segregation in the F3, we discarded them. Based on that, we were able to build a high bulk that this is putting the DNA together of all the plants that were homogeneous for the black pod trait, in this case 47, and for the ones that were Norman coloration, in this case 25. We also got a DNA sample for each one of our parents, FloRun 331 and the black pods. In terms of sequencing, after we got the data from the sequencing, we aligned each parent to the reference genome of TIFFRunner, the version 2. We did some filter, we called the SNPs, and then we built a new reference based on the black pot parent and a new reference based on the FloRun parent. We aligned those two bulks, the high and the low bulk, to each of these new reference sequences. We again did some filtering and we also called the SNPs, and that data that we got from all this pipeline was imputed in the QTLseq R. In terms of sequencing, we got a genome coverage of around 25% in average for all our sequencing and alignment to both of these new reference genomes. And we had a mean depth of 15 once we consider all of these alignments. In total, we found 416, 87, and 17 SNPs when we were using the black pot assembly. And then when we were using the FloRun 321 assembly, we found 367,978 SNPs. In common, we had 220,714 SNPs. All of these SNPs were put together in files and then were imputed into QTLseq R in R program. And this package helped us doing a little bit more of filtering. It allowed us to calculate the SNP index for every single SNP and as well as every single delta SNP and also the G statistics for each SNP that we identified. These are the results whenever we are using the black pot as a reference genome. As you can see, we see all the 20 chromosomes of the peanut. In this case, we are looking at delta SNP. At that SNP index. And as you can see, the only one that it's above the 95% confidence level is chromosome 20 in this case. We see the same whenever we're looking at the G statistics, our peak is above the 3.2 false detection ratio. And so because of that, we are only going to focus on that particular chromosome. In this case, we are looking at the results based on whenever we are using the FloRun 331 reference genome. So we were able to identify a QTL found in this chromosome with a length of 5.36 megabases. Whenever we contrast this to when we use the black pot as the reference, we can see the same area is within the area, the area we identified in FloRun 31 is within the area that we identified in the black pots. In the black pots, we identified a genome area of 13.75 megabases. So we are looking basically at the same region whenever we use both of these. And based on this, we identified these two regions. In both cases, these are highly significant whenever we are focusing only on delta SNP. The Q value is a adjusted P value that is going to identify the significance of the G statistics. On this, we identify 694 SNPs in the region identified whenever we use the black pots as a reference. When we use the FloRun 321 as a reference, we identify 669 SNPs. And in common, we only had 10 SNPs in this region. All of these SNPs were then imputed into a SNP effect to identify the effects of all of these SNPs, and we only focus on those that were missense or they had another change. We didn't focus into intron variants or synonymous SNPs. In this case, we were able to identify a SNP that was had a change of nucleotide in the 3' untranscribed region, which it has a function of trypsin-like serine protease, which is sometimes related with disease. We need to look a little bit more into this, and that's what we are going to do in next steps. As you can see, whenever this same SNP was identified in both cases when we used the black pots and the FloRun 331 as reference. And then we had other two SNPs that were used as that were identified only when we use the FloRun 331 as a reference. This is that this the change of the nucleotide is actually coming from the black pots. So in this case, both of them are missense SNF effects. And one is an anchorized protein, and the other one is an ABC transporter family protein. This is mainly more linked to movement of proteins within cellular walls. So this could be explain a little bit more of the coloration and of the black spots. So in conclusion, we were successfully we developed a population, and the DNA of the individuals were successfully also extracted to complete a whole genome sequencing. We also completed a SNP call and a QTLseq analysis based on the black spot trait. It was possible to identify one region of 5.46 megabases in chromosome B10 of the peanut genome. And we were also able to identify three SNPs as variants between the black spot lines, the FloRun 331, and the TIF runner referent genome. Our future work is to develop competitive allele-specific PCR markers to identify, to confirm the link of these identified SNPs with the black spots. We want to do the confirmation of the candidate SNPs in a second population. We need to build another population to confirm these results. We want to continue the evaluation of black spot peanuts and their other agronomic uses. This is also has to do with the results that I showed in the introduction. We are trying to look more into the effects of the black spots into the Aspergillus infection and aflatoxin contamination. We also want to start the integration of the black spot traits into elite germplasm. We are actually working on into this, and we have already done some selections based on this population that we have created for this specific program, for this specific research, sorry. And with that, I want to finish my presentation. So I want to thank Dr. Barry Tillman and Dr. Japing Wang from UF that they have been really supportful in all my research. I also want to thank Dr. George Clevenger and Dr. C. Peng that they were a huge help in terms of bioinformatics. I also want to thank the peanut breeding program crew here at the North Florida Research and Education Center in Mariana, and the National Peanut Board and Southern Peanut Research Initiative and Peanut Research Foundation for funding this research. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Marco. And we have time for questions. First question is coming from Dr. Albert Colbert. Is there any indication whether pod extract effects would vary with maturity of the pod?
Thank you, doctor. We have not seen this particularly because whenever we do the extracts of to do the evaluations of the effects on Aspergillus and aflatoxin, we have only selecting pods that were fully mature. But this is something that it seems very interesting, and we are more than open to start looking at this.
Okay. Any other questions for Marco? All right, Marco, thank you very much for participating in this session. Thank you for an excellent presentation.
Thank you.